Hey everyone, thank you so much for checking out this latest video of me 1 month post-op breast augmentation. So yeah, I want to get right into it. Basically, I had my breast augmentation surgery on April 28th and it was pretty simple and straightforward. Like I was like still moving around that same day after surgery. I mean, there was pain and everything, but it wasn't like so intense that it wasn't like vaginoplasty, let's just put it that way. 2 weeks after the surgery, I was ready to get back out into work and doing other things. So I definitely am glad I did it. And but now that it's been 1 month, I'm definitely just looking, you know, and seeing the results, and I'm happy with them. I definitely feel like the surgeon didn't go too big, but he didn't go too small either. So it's like, it feels like just the right size. So yeah, I'm really happy with the results. I definitely think that my surgeon did a good job and I was able to take the tape off from underneath this past Friday and start putting on scar solution. And it gets a little itchy there, especially because I had to wear sports bras and everything, but now I have just a regular bra on and it's not too bad. I'm actually, you know, just happy with how things are looking and I'm, yeah, totally excited to just be able to be this much further along in my transition. And I'm grateful also that insurance was able to cover it, because I think maybe again, that might not be what everybody talks about on here, about how insurance can cover these surgeries. And a lot of times that's necessary in order to get them. I know it was for me, or it is for me. Otherwise I wouldn't have been able to afford them. I mean, I guess I could have saved up, but yeah, I didn't go that route. I had the opportunity to get breast augmentation at the same time I got vaginoplasty back in February, but I decided against it because of the fact that I just thought it might be too painful, two big surgeries at once, especially since my surgery is under the muscle for a more natural look. Thank goodness it is in that respect. So, but yeah, I basically feel like the surgery kind of was like no big deal compared to what I had with vaginoplasty and even what I had with my tracheal shape, because there was a lot of concern there with just like my throat and everything and cutting into my throat and all of that and potentially wrecking my vocal cords. You know, that's been known to happen. So breast augmentation is just like, well, you know, yeah, one and done or two and done. So, and I had them play the Promising Young Woman soundtrack as they put me under. And yeah, I was ready to go. So, but unfortunately, there's a big piece missing to this puzzle. And while I'm grateful that I was able to get my insurance to cover my trach shave, my vaginoplasty, and my breast augmentation, and while I might sound like some poor, cheap trans person here on YouTube, you know what? I'm being honest and real and everyday for you and not giving you some, oh, well, these are all the surgeries I have that you can't afford, because guess what? I can't afford them either, but I was thankful enough to be able to get them and be in states where I was able to get them. But unfortunately, I'm not able to get facial feminization surgery in the state that I'm currently in under state insurance. There are several states that allow that, which are Massachusetts, Minnesota, New York, California. I think there's also New Jersey. There's a number of them, but basically I'm currently in Maryland and I'm not able to get it covered under state insurance. I've been fighting it. So I'm waiting to hear back from the appeal I sent in. I've also been working with a legal rights organization. I've been working with a number of other places, also advocacy with two other trans individuals reaching out to delegates for the advocacy of facial feminization surgery or facial gender affirmation surgery, and then also electrolysis for facial hair removal or genital hair removal for that matter. You know, I can't tell you the amount of times I drank just because of the fact that I couldn't afford electrolysis and my facial hair was driving the hell out of me, you know, driving me crazy. And, you know, I just couldn't take it. But I'm thankful to be in a place where I can afford these things and where I was able to be out in California prior to this and get all of my facial electrolysis pretty much and have it covered under state insurance. But unfortunately, circling back to it in this state I'm in now, a lot of those rights were denied to me moving back here. And that presented obstacles with and so now I'm more than likely going to have to move back to California in order to get facial feminization surgery. But I feel like that might be the best thing anyway, because the surgeons there are more experienced probably, and knowing, I might be wrong, but anyway, they're, you know, familiar with taking state insurance. And so I just basically have to just be like, hey, the glass is half full. It shouldn't be this way at all. It shouldn't have to be this, you know, fucking fight, but it is. And I mean, I can get into that more in detail later on. But basically, you know, this, I want to make sure that, you know, this video is dedicated to me 1 month post-op. I'm very happy. This is the first time I've worn a low-cut top just for the purpose of this video, so you can see without seeing too much. And, you know, I'm excited to be able to go out, but I definitely feel that now that I have top surgery, that I have breast augmentation, I definitely need to finish it up. Like, it's going to just be, I need to, like, have my face done as well, not just my bottom surgery and top surgery, but my face as well, to be able to complete it. And that also goes along with passing too. You know, your face is what everyone's going to see first and foremost. And if you're not passing, you know, then that could put you at risk of discrimination. Not saying we should have to pass, but, you know, sometimes for our safety and everything, there's an importance in that. And I know for me, being able to wear masks through COVID has actually helped me not to feel so insecure about my face, or I've been insecure about my face, but I haven't had to worry about what others think of it or that others are seeing the insecurities that I'm now feeling that I'm sober and everything else. So anyway, it's a lot. And I can definitely get into the facial feminization surgery journey in later episodes when I actually do plan to do. But for now, I definitely want to make sure that I am talking enough about breast augmentation. So yeah, I checked out my size and I'm a 36C, which I think is a great size. And, you know, it feels fitting for my body proportionally. You know, I mean, I'm definitely a lot bigger than I was with just hormones alone, which could not only do so much for breast growth. And that's another thing, hormones themselves. I was hoping that that would do it all. Like when I started physically transitioning at 22, taking hormones, I was like hoping that the hormones themselves would be enough to just provide me enough breasts. And I was like going for that all natural, you know, look and no implants. But at the end of the day, I just realized that they weren't gonna, it wasn't doing the trick, and it's time for the implants. So, but yeah, I mean, I'm definitely, you know, feeling very much more confident in myself, you know, and just knowing that I have these surgeries, most of them underway, and that I'm getting my final one worked toward, whether, you know, and raising awareness in the process. So I am looking forward, in a sense, to my transition journey being over, but I'm also trying to see it as a marathon and not a sprint, and be grateful that, you know, I'm having this time to be able to focus on this. And yeah. So anyway, this is me, 1 month post-op breast augmentation. Please like and subscribe. I really appreciate you for watching and caring and showing your support. And I hope you have a great rest of your day, night, or whenever you are watching.